Therefore, this sort of meeting is absolutely necessary to strengthen our faith in Swami. You will also be surprised to know that more miracles are happening today than before. Yes. And these miracles are getting into the notice of maximum number of people. And I have been speaking of miracles happening elsewhere. Rarely miracles happen here within the campus, Prashanthalayam. Because it's a miracle that we are staying here, there is enough of miracle. Enough of a miracle, not more is necessary. But miracles started happening here, that is a shock to me. During Dasara time, somebody said, Mr. Anil Kumar, you come there in South Indian canteen, Vibhuti is falling from Swami's picture. Though I have been talking about it, watching it for 40 years, out of curiosity I went there. Because the person who told me should not think that I lost faith in Swami, or I take in a simple way, casual way, they should not underestimate my standards of devotion. So somehow I went, because she says Sai Ram to me in all humility with all that, and I may lose one of my fans that way. So I went. And I saw with my own eyes Vibhuti falling from Swami's picture. There is a South Indian canteen, ladies' side. After some time, Baba might have thought gents also should have some miracle. There cannot be any discrimination, you see, on grounds of gender. So, somebody said, oh, miracle is happening towards the gent side also, why don't you come? Well, I went there. Of course, it's for my own safety. What did I notice there? On the wall, we saw Swami's footprints. Swami's footprints, we saw there. They lasted for a long time. And now the latest thing is, again ladies' side. Swami may be oscillating like a pendulum, ladies' side and gents' side, with equal share. Now I am told that honey is coming from Swami's picture. Yes. And it is so huge, you see. They kept a big plate, it seems. It is also filled with nectar. Yes. Maybe these things are given to us, rather we are blessed with these miracles only to wipe out that feeling that Swami is not amidst us, that Swami left us all of a sudden. So Swami wants to safeguard his own devotees, because he knows how fluctuating devotees are. It took about 8 years for him to gather this strength. He is not prepared to lose it anyway. That's how he took it. So, that's happening. And I had been to Chennai, the former Madras. There openly at the entrance, you have Swami's footprints there. Sundaram, Swami's place, Sundaram. I have seen Swami's footprints there. Vibhuti gathering there. Recently some say that Sivalingam appeared or something like that. So we have Chennai representatives, never think that I am bluffing. We have got some here. So that's happening there, Sivalingam appearing. Well, is it anything new for us, or are we hearing for the first time? Or shall we take it in a casual, usual manner? Or shall we say we are above these things? Nonsense. I take it this way. For when all of us are feeling the separation, feeling so bad because of the separation, Swami wants to cheer up everybody. He wants to make everyone smile. Be happy. Be assured of His divine presence. Nothing less than Divine Presence gives us the joy. If I tell everybody, don't worry, I'm going to speak on Swami's Satsai Speaks Volume 2 and 3. Nobody, 2 or 3 also won't be here. That I'm sure. With all said and done, all the philosophy, our association with Him, with the physical body, naturally will make us reminisce or think of the past, memories. These things will naturally happen. So, because of that, Swami is granting these miracles to feel the association, His existence and His divine presence, His concern and love for the devotees. That's how I take it. And secondly, till now, very few miracles must have happened here within Prashanthi Lanka campus. Because nobody told me, these are happening, come and see. These things are happening recently. Why not then? Why now? Well, I've been thinking like this. We are so busy doing our own job. Those working in the university, working in the hospital, mandir, so busy. We have become very, very mechanical. Maybe if you have glimpses of spiritual experience, these things may be happening. Why not? I'm so busy with my own studies. I'm so busy with my own canteen and the bill books. I'm so busy pushing people as Sevadal man here and there. Though there's no crowd, I like to push everybody because hands are used to that. There may not be any crowd at all. But hands wants to push, I'm not responsible. Because I got used to it over decades. This is the feeling of the Sevadal. So when we are so mechanical, it's time that we should turn to spirituality. And so Swami might have thought that these fellows need some experiences, some miracles, to think of me now and then, rather being in a mechanical life. Mechanical life. That's how I feel it. Thanks to Swami, slowly, slowly, people are recovering from this shock. Now what is needed, we'll come to that in due course of time. It's because of Swami's will, I could visit Thailand recently. I had been to Thailand on 5th and I stayed there till 8th. Thailand. Well, I have a new passport because old passport expired and I have a new passport. With this new passport, I traveled to places like Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia and Brunei, last one, just before Baba's birthday. Nobody said it's okay, okay, it's all stamps and everything fine. But this time I went on my way to Bangkok, at Bangalore airport, at the immigration counter, that man says, stand here. I said, why? First you stand there. And he disposed other people in the line. Finally came to me, you cannot go. Already my baggage is checked in. This man wants to check me out. I said, why sir, you cannot go, I tell you, he said. Why? There in the passport, one number on the top is different from another number at the bottom, scrawl, magnetic scrawl. Number will be at two places, one at the right hand side, one at the bottom. On the top, the last digits are 99. At the bottom, 101. So you cannot go to. Sir, the same passport I went to Malaysia, that's a different thing. You cannot go now. I see. Then what's my number, 99 or 101? Let me know my number at least. That your number is not 99, as given on the top, which is noted in all my visas there. Not 99. How do you know? I said, what, mister? This computer age, why do you put that question? Don't you know that? This computer age. Okay. I can't expose my innocence. Okay, then I said, who is this 90 passport holder with number 99? A Muslim is the passport holder. I'm not a Muslim, at least for this lifetime. So, a Muslim is passport holder, how can you travel? Stand there. Then, there in Thailand, there are meetings and people are waiting, hotel reservations are done, invitations are widely circulated, and they're waiting. What am I to do? Then I pleaded with him again and again. Somehow, even stones also sometimes melt. First time I saw that. And that man little bit softened, little bit. Then he said, all right, even if I send you there at the Bangkok airport, you'll be deported, you'll have to come back. I say, should I go to come back immediately? No. Then I said, okay, sir. But one thing, if I am sent back, good. But will I be put behind the bars or jailed? Will I be put in jail or what? No, no, that won't happen. They'll put you in the next immediate flight and ask you to fly back. Okay, sir, that's fine, why not? So, luckily in my pocket, I was carrying the number of, for the address of one gentleman in charge of Bangkok Sai Center. I was having his number. I asked the gentleman, would you please talk to him so that he may tell you the position. He said, do you have time sense, he said. I said, what do you mean by time sense? It is either at 1 o'clock or 1:30 midnight there. You want to speak to him now. Why do you want to disturb them? I told them, if I don't go, they'll be more disturbed. This disturbance is a welcoming disturbance. They welcome it because they know where I am at least. The melting process started. He got himself softened a little bit and said, my office phone is not working. Oh, wonderful cooperative levels. Then I said, if you don't mind, why don't you phone from your personal phone? He looked at me from the top and, how dare you say that? I said, sir, if you want. Oh, somehow, I don't know, goodness must have prevailed upon him, or Baba must have prompted him, please do it. So that man called him on phone. And immediately he got the reply, send him first, we'll take care of him next. Next to what? To send me back or what? I don't know, send him first, we'll take care of him next. I such a tension I never had. For 4 hours until I reached Bangkok. Because, take care next, what care? I don't know. By the time I went to Bangkok airport, there at the immigration counter, one gentleman started smiling at me. People can smile for two occasions, positive and the negative. So this man is smiling lovingly. Then I thought, maybe a friend. He was having some badge and name and all that. He suddenly came. Because it seems those people are allowed to freely move at the airport. And he said, I'm Mr. Mani. I'm a diplomat working in United Nations organization. I'm a member of Sai Center, Bangkok. I have come here to take you, don't worry, nobody will say anything. So he came there. And he escorted me, somehow I could come out. So I will take care next, that is over. So I went there. And there I tell you, this foreign diplomat working in an organization is a member of Sai organization as if he meant for me. As if, I don't know. He got up at 4 o'clock in the morning to report himself at 6:30 at the airport. Okay, I went there, and Thailand is such a beautiful land, and of course, though you like it or not, most of the films are shot from that place, Bangkok. Most of Telugu films, I don't know about other films. They say many, many films shot from Bangkok. Very good. I visited that place around 20 years ago. 20 years ago. This is the second visit. And most of the people know Bhagavan Sri Satsai Baba. Most of the people know him. And very interesting thing is, about 200 miles away from Bangkok is present Sai School. And the Sai School is efficiently managed by a gentleman by name Jum Sai. Jum Sai is a reputed and most respected person in the field of education. Jum Sai received his degrees from Harvard University, US, Oxford University, UK, and also served as a scientist in the Viking spaceship. Related to the royal family, and started a Dhamma party all by himself. A very nice gentleman. And that school also runs an institute to train teachers in Sai education in human values. Sai education in human values training is offered there in Bangkok with the divine blessings of Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba. I know Jum Sai being blessed by Bhagwan whenever he happened to visit this place, Swami guiding him at every state, and this man explaining things. He was quite at a very high standard in Sai circles. And Sai school is so beautiful. And the way to Sai school will make you remember Puttaparthi, because some roads are as bad as this, to make you feel at home. And you will also find some bullock carts also, so that you don't forget your culture. Somehow, full of sandy road, full of gravel, and you have bumps and jumps. Good, because let me not forget my roots, you know. So, and there you go. But when once you go in, it is a paradise. Something like Puttaparthi. Until you approach Prasanthalayam, it's a different world altogether. Altogether. Suddenly bus goes there as if it's getting into a house. But it takes a turn there. That's where we feel Baba's miracle. So the point is that there is a school which is so nicely built, like our Sri Satsai primary school. And there's a wonderful hostel attached to it. They have got a prayer hall, a dining hall, and guest rooms, plus parents to talk to their children. They have a very big venue for them. Very nice, little children. And there's also river-like thing close to school, reminding Chitravati, as thin, as thick as this Chitravati. But school is excellent. The teachers are totally committed. And they offer training at the international level. They must have given training to hundreds of teachers. It's a matter of privilege and pleasure to visit that school, Sai School, which is of international reputation, the institute in particular. And there, for the last 22 years or 25, one headmistress has been there by name Sister Lorraine. Lorraine is a British by birth, but she settled there in Bangkok. She breathes Sai, she dines Sai, she lives in Sai, she is Sai herself embodied. Nothing else. The face and talk, the movements are very clear. A kind of reflection of Bhagavan Sri Satsai Baba. So engrossed, so much immersed, involved in Sai activity, education wing. It is impossible to talk any other subject with her other than Swami. Impossible. I tried and totally failed. So nice to have met such stalwarts. And I met this Jum Sai. He has got such a faith, I tell you, bedrock that cannot be shaken. I said, Jum Sai, thank you for being here with us. He said, Swami sent me, thank you. I say, oh, will you be present tomorrow? Because I had the next meeting. If Swami permits, I will come. What am I to speak such orthodox Sai devotees? More concentrated than Catholics or Vaishnavites of Hinduism or Al-Qaeda movement. Babri Masjid level of devotion. Every Swami permits, I'll come. If Swami sent, I'll come. That's the only thing what they were telling. Oh, it's a kind of education to me. And some of the children presented nice dance, classical dance, very good. And some of the children did some Singapore dance, Singapore Chinese dance. It was also very nice. And their dance programs are followed by talks. And I gave two talks. That's the only thing I can do in this lifetime. And that is followed by question-answer session, which is a very interesting thing. And the question answers, well, will make everybody in jitters, because there is no question of hiding. They'll put your question straight. If you can answer, say that, or else, Hari Om Tat Sat. You cannot bluff, no. Because they know everything like that. You cannot philosophize, no. Because some people take to philosophy as an escape. That Swami's will, shut up. Why do you say, it's Swami's will that I should pull your collar now? Would you accept it? It's not that. We cannot bluff. By Swami's grace, I could answer all their questions. I should say that because the questions were so sensitive. But somehow I emerged out of it successfully. And later I was interviewed by journalists, and that a whole article, the paper covered the entire interview by a top journalist. That was also published in the paper by the title, The Nation. All the talks and also the newspaper information it carried, they are all available in the website, saiwisdom.com. SaiWisdom.com. SaiWisdom.com is a website where you will have all the information. All this. Newspaper information is there. The talks, you may have to wait for 2 to 3 days. That also you will get it. What I want to share with you is how much I was shocked there, because I was detained there at the airport. So my constant thought is that, how to change this? Two numbers, what to do? I started working on that even from the day I landed there. Though I was speaking fine and all that, yet it has been my constant integrated awareness. What am I to do? Because all that I have been doing, and there's a lot of discussion, counterparts and all that, finally, they said, you should go to Hyderabad and get a new booklet. So my Thailand visit, Hyderabad visit, led to the cancellation of some of our Sunday satsangs. All this I have to submit to you as a kind of explanation for my absence. Because some of you may be positively expecting me to talk to you on Sundays. Suddenly when they find this fellow is absconding, well, naturally you may feel disappointed. And some may feel happy because this fellow left for good. So, that's a different thing, you see. The way how we look at things. While some are anxious about your stay, some are eager about your exit as well. That's what life is. We got used to this kind of situation all through. I understand that tomorrow is Chinese New Year's Day, Chinese New Year's Day. And I wanted to know the details. New Year Day is New Year Day, doesn't matter Chinese or Japanese or Indians, New Year Day is meaningful. New Year Day itself is self-explanatory. We don't have to dig deep into the matter. But I saw a few Buddhist monks there yesterday. Buddhist monks, about 8 of them or so. I saw them also. And on inquiry, I came to know that they will be chanting verses from Buddhist texts. chanting Buddhist texts this evening, that they'll be doing. Sir, what? Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Hari Om. Good, good. So, these are all their chantings with English meaning also given. But it is difficult to chant and maintain that kind of uniformity. If we try, it is too late. Better we read its meaning and be satisfied for the time being. So, thank you, sir. Now I want to know the correlation between monks' visit and Chinese New Year. How is their visit related to Chinese New Year? Is the New Year related to Buddhism or Buddha related to New Year? What is the matter? So, that lady was telling that she would give us a brief write-up. But as I did some homework, I remember Swami saying many things about Lord Buddha. It's not my idea to repeat what all he said about Buddha either. But really, it's most interesting to note this kind of interpretation from Bhagavan, and nobody did it so far. Nobody. Nobody. It's only Swami. Students of comparative religions would agree with me that they have not come across such an interpretation till this day. What is the interpretation? That I want to bring to your notice this pleasant morning. One interpretation he said is this. Of course, incidentally, I may tell you Swami is like a diamond. What he says this time need not necessarily be same next time. It won't contradict, but it gives a different dimension altogether, a different angle of perception, a different direction altogether. That's what he does it. So one time he said it, of all the human dynamics in the human body, what is the most important is buddhi or intellect. Buddhi or intellect is special in mankind. It is not there in the mineral matter, is not there in the plant world, is not there in the animal world either. Buddhi, intellect, is a special faculty gifted to mankind, human race. And this buddhi is close to consciousness or spirit. Buddhi is very close to consciousness or spirit or atma. Therefore, intellect reflects what is contained in atma. Reflection, that's all. Because it is so close. Therefore, it is said, buddhigrahyamatindriyam. Buddhigrahyamatindriyam, meaning intellect is above the senses. It is close to the consciousness, super consciousness, or atma, or the spirit, reflecting its majesty, reflecting its grandeur, reflecting its glory, its essence. So one should look up to the intellect. How to know it is intellect? Swami tells this, that which discriminates, that which judges, that which decides is intellect. Decision making, judgmental, is the job of intellect. One should intellect. But usually we don't do that. We go by the command of the mind. What is the mind? Mind is emotional. Mind is sentimental. Mind is full of feelings. Mind is full of thoughts, bundle of desires. Thoughts, counter thoughts, desires, that is the mind. So when once we act at the level of the mind, naturally we'll have its shocks, its dualistic experience, pain and pleasure. But when I go be transcend mind, go to the intellect, I'll be awakened. The consciousness is raised. I'm in a blissful state because it is close to Atma or the spirit. Now Swami says, Buddha is the one who has gone to the state of experiencing the intellect, Buddhi. So Buddha stands for Buddhi, meaning intellect, awakened intellect, realized intellect, the intellect which is a replica of the consciousness, which is a carbon copy of Atma. So Buddha awakened Buddhi, awakened Buddhi or intellect. Now Swami says, if you are awakened, if your intellect is awakened, it is individual. It's only individual achievement or individual accomplishment or individual attainment, totally individual. Then now Swami says, next step. It is not enough if you are individually awakened. You should also be in the society. You should also be in the society. You should also be in the community, because you are not alone. We are in society. We have a family. We have a community around. We interact with many, many people. So, from the individual, one has to travel to the community. Okay? When you are in a community, it is not enough if you satisfy. You should try to realize the cosmic divinity in the individual and also in the community. Meaning, the divinity in the community is as much the same as the divinity in the individual. Vyashti, the individual. Samishti, the community. Parameshti, the divinity. Parameshti, the divinity, is the community in a cosmic form, which is present in the same quantum, or which is present in the same way. At the individual level also, Vyashti. That's how Swami explains. And this experience of the divinity at the individual level as well as at the community level is sadhana. Sadhana or spiritual practice, that is what is called self-realization. Self-realization meaning the self in me is same as the self in everyone. So Buddha represents three levels. The first level, individual level. The second level, community. And third level, interlink between the two, the divinity finally, which is present in both, linking both. That is a wonderful definition that Baba has given. It's not to my knowledge anyone gave such an explanation. At another time he gave another interpretation, wonderful. Because of awakening of the intellect or Buddhi, Buddha is enlightened. With that enlightenment he did not keep quiet. With that enlightened situation, with that enlightened mind, awakened intellect, he stepped into society. He spent more than 48 years or so serving people. After a long period of penance, after a long period of austerities, he observed. He spent about 48 years in the community. So he started serving them. He started talking to them. and thereby helped everyone to know the righteousness and the righteous conduct. This Swami explains this way. Buddham saranam gacchami. Buddham saranam gacchami. The usual sense, the meaning is surrender to Buddha. That is the usual meaning. Saranam gacchami Buddham. I surrender to Lord Buddha. But what is the significant meaning given by Baba? Surrender to your Buddhi, intellect. You understand that? Surrender to your Buddhi, intellect. Not to your mind with which you have been spending lives and lives. Lives and lives are spent because of total identification with the mind. Same thing Ramana Maharshi also says. Ramana Maharshi says this point. Birth, rebirth, hell, heaven, good, bad, virtue and a sin. All these things, birth and rebirth, all these dualities come into the picture. So long the mind functions. So long I function at the level of the mind. So long I identify with the mind. These things are valid. These things exist. When I cross the mind, finish, there is neither hell nor heaven. There is neither sin nor merit. There is neither birth nor death. So, understand that at intellectual level. Buddham saranam gacchami. Surrender to Buddhi, awakened intellect. With that, what should you do? Join the community, serve the society. Sangham saranam gacchami. Sangham saranam gacchami. I salute to the community, my obeisance to the society. I realize my obligations to the society. I also serve people to make them happy. Service. So, Sangham Saranam Gacchami. So, as an individual, as a community, as a member of the community, as you do this, your job is only to experience the Self within. That is the duty for which we are born. That's what Swami says, Dharmam Saranam Gacchami. Dharmam Saranam Gacchami. That is your dharma. So, that is your dharma, our duty to experience the Self. Therefore, the Gita says, Swadharme nidharam sreyaha, paradharmo bhayavaha. Paradharma, any other pursuit, any other endeavor, any other goals, bhayavaha, fearful. But swadharme nidhanam sreyaha, to experience your own Self, sreyaha, best path for you. So that is dharmam saranam gacchami. So buddham saranam gacchami, sangham saranam gacchami, dharmam saranam gacchami are the three levels of awareness, are the three levels of consciousness, are the three rungs in a ladder for Self. Realization. Can anyone say that this interpretation is given by anybody? Nobody. He alone can say that. He is Bhagavan Sri Satsai Baba. He alone can say that. Nobody can say that. That won't strike our mind. Because easy to fall in front of a picture, easy to fall in front of an idol, and put some money there, go back with full satisfaction of earning merit or punya. But this kind of psychological approach suitable to the contemporary society, Baba only could do. I would draw your attention. One more thing I heard long back, say in the year 1972, it was Dr. Bhagavantam, yes, Bhagavantam, who was the translator of Bhagavan's discourses for 10 years. Dr. Bhagavantam is a highly accomplished person in the field of science, And there is no scientist who does not know his name. He served as vice chancellor to some of the universities. Later he was also scientific advisor, Defense Council of India. Such a prominent man, Baba's devotee. He used to stay there in Purnachandra Auditorium, just by the side of Swami's room. People say that he enjoys fun. People say that he has got enough of sense of humor. But as we look at him, we forget how to smile. He has such a serious face like that. You feel as if you committed some mistake like that. Yes, he's always serious. But an inquiry I came to know that he too laughs. That he too smiles and enjoys jokes. Oh, well, I had not experienced anyway. That apart, a very great man in science, very great man. And he spoke in the presence of Bhagwan in the year 72, in summer, at the time of, classes, Indian culture and spirituality, summer classes. He gave a talk. That's what it is which I want to share with you. He said this: it seems one doctor from Japan came here by name Hayakawa, a doctor from Japan University. Well, he came here and with other Japanese devotees, and Swami gave him interview. While talking to that Dr. Hayakawa, Swami said many things about Buddha and incidentally mentioned, "Look here, Hayakawa, your heart has only 3 chambers. Heart should have 4 chambers." But Swami says, "Look here, your heart only has 3 chambers." Thank God, he did not lose other chambers to listening to this shock. Naturally, when Swami says he got only 1 chamber finished, the other, that also stops functioning. But this man is a brave man. He said, "What? No, Swami. The science says you have 4 chambers." I said, "Keep quiet. You have only 3, I say." Then he said, "How do you know?" He asked Swami, "How do you know?" "I know." "How do you know?" I say. "Not only me here, there are 2 others that know." "Who are they, Swami?" "One doctor, another the nurse. When you are born, at the time of the delivery, the nurse on duty and the doctor, they only 2 know the secret." And doctor whispered this to your mother. Nobody else knows this. This man got more of tension. Till then he was all right. He was thinking that he has 4 chambers like anybody, very good. When he said -1, 3, and that too when his mother knows, Abba, finish. Then he came out of Mandir at the end of the interview. Then he contacted one of the local booths there, made an international phone call, Tokyo, to his mother. "Mom, what? Is it true that my heart has only 3 chambers?" And she says, "Who said that?" "Who said or not, that's a different thing. Please tell me that is it true that my heart has 3 chambers?" She says, "Shut up, nobody knows, how do you know?" "Nobody knows, how do you know?" And "nobody knows, how do you know" means somebody know. "Nobody knows, how do you know," you said, meaning somebody knows. "So I should know who knows." Then mother says, "I only know, nobody else. Nobody else, I didn't tell you all these years. The one who told you must have been God only, nothing else. No one else. Only God only can tell you. No human being knows this," she said. Then this gentleman is a professor, doctor by profession. He said, "Mummy, our God is Lord Buddha. Buddha will not speak about 3 chambers in the heart, 4 chambers in the heart. He is not a cardiologist." Why do you say that? Then mother says, "Arey, you're a fool. Buddha is enlightened, awakened intellect. Awakened Buddha. He is all-knowing. So he knows it. He is God himself." Then this man got a little bit awakening and then sat for darshan in the evening. Swami goes that way and says, "Hayakova, what does your mother say?" This man, "Well, my mother, what has she to say, Swami?" "Are, three or four. What, Swami? Three chambers or four chambers? Tell me, what does your mother?" Then he fell at his feet, "Swami, my mother said that I have three chambers." Then Baba said, "I know. What did other thing that your mother say?" "My mother has not said, hey, what do other thing tell me?" Then he granted him interview immediately. Then immediately Swami asked him, "What is the other thing that your mother said?" Then, "Swami, my mother said, the one who said that my heart has only three chambers cannot be anyone else other than God." Then Baba, "Now you understand that?" "Now you understand that? Okay, Swami." And then Swami said, "Then what did you say?" It is something like a cricket commentary. Unbelievable. When Swami takes to that, he'll take you till the end. He won't leave you. You may forget your conversation, but he does not. He'll make you recall. Yes. And then said, "What other thing? What did you say?" "I told my mother, Swami, that our God is Buddha. He does not know about the heart." "Oho. Your mother kept quiet, or what did she say?" "No, Swami, my mother said, Buddha is God, God is Buddha, Buddha is you, Satya Sai Baba, and Buddha are one." "That's what my mother said, Swami." This, Dr. Bhagavatam narrated this miracle in the year 1972 during one of his talks at the time of the summer courses on Indian culture and spirituality. Why I bring this to your notice is this. A beautiful phenomenon, Sai spiritual revolution, is gifted to mankind that would help us to understand the unity of faiths, synthesis of religions, the congregation of worship, such that we believe that unity, that single entity, which is the only divinity. Perhaps I can even say that there is no other place where Buddha celebrations take place twice a year. I don't know. Chinese year they are linking up with this. And again we have 28th, I believe, is Buddha Purnima. There is another celebration there. I was also told that there is one pilot from Singapore and he got permission from Swami to bring monks here every year, coinciding with Chinese New Year, who would chant certain portions from their text, sacred text. That's what I was told. But still I'm working on that, because I'm an academic man, want to know in depth what is it happening around. So my friends, with these words, I take leave of you for this morning, and we will be meeting again. Oh, next Sunday, what is the date? 4th, right? Hari Om. Oh, 29th? Oh, I'll be here. But 4th, I'll be in the state of Haryana and Punjab. They have youth conference in both the states. I'll be in Chandigarh on 4th. So next week, we'll certainly meet. Okay? We'll certainly meet. My sincere apologies to you, all of you, once again, for my absence during the last two sessions. Thank you very much. You want to ask something? Oh, her question is, I didn't understand dharmam charanam gacchami. She wants me to explain that particular part. Dharmam saranam gacchami. Out of three, Buddham saranam gacchami, Sangham saranam gacchami, Dharmam saranam gacchami. The word dharma in Sanskrit is such a word which is multidimensional. It has got so many interpretations, so many meanings also. But the one that we have to take here is prime duty. It is my dharma, my main duty. What is my main duty? To know the self. So, understanding of the self, awareness of the self, manifestation of the self, experience of the self is my dharma. So, when once you understand the self, experience self, you will have the blissful life. Because self is the bliss. God is bliss. Bliss is God. Self is God. God is the self. So you will have that blissful experience when once you are after that. Dharmam saranam gacchami. Concentrate. Meditate. Experience the self and enjoy the blissful situation. Otherwise, if you follow other things, paradharmo bhayavaha, if you follow other dharmas, like money earning, or position mongering, or politicking everywhere, bhayavaha, it is the fearful, that's what it is. Am I clear? Thank you. Any other question, please? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The engineer, electronic engineer, that worked in space.
Mr. Sai Jun Sai, yeah.
And he had a huge problem that he was trying to solve. Nobody else could solve. One day he started meditating.
Why don't you come here and share that everybody will hear you? Please come. No, sir.
Yeah.
This is what satsang is. Please. He has got very interesting thing to share with us.
Yeah,
sir, please come.
Just about Jem Sai is, he was an electronic engineer in Space Center in the United States. So when they had a huge problem, nobody else could figure out. But Jem Sai meditated on Sai. And that night, Sai helped him to solve the problem. And next morning he went and bingo, everything was solved.
Oh, it's my mistake.
The second part of the question that
you want second part? First part is you heard. Repeat, they said. Beg your pardon. Repeat first part. It doesn't matter because we are all devotees, you know, they love it.
The electronic engineer from Thailand, Rocco was talking about, he mentioned most of his stuff. But I also know that that engineer had problems. And most of the engineers had problems. Nobody could solve this problem on the spacecraft. But he meditated on Sai. And one day, Baba came into his dream and he solved the problem. And next morning he went and fixed it and he was fine. The second point I wanted to ask you was, I have read the Bhagavad Gita and I have read your version as well. And he never mentions the word about God.
Yes.
And why is it?
He has not, yes, you are right. Buddha has not mentioned any time this word God. He never used it. Baba said at one time, why? When you use the word God, what is the next? There must be some other one. There must be something else. God and man? God and creation? What? He didn't make a mention of it because God is existence. The one without the second. If there are two, I can mention that. And I have to mention the second also. When God is the only one without the second, there's nothing to say about it. So he kept quiet. So Buddha remained silent because he just believed in non-duality of the divinity, which is not your only one without the second. When there's only one, what am I to say about it? When there are two, I can say one thing, so that the other thing could be identified, differentiated, distinguished. When there's only one, what am I to say about it? Therefore, Buddha remained silent. That's what Baba said. Okay, sir? Om samasta loka sukhino bhavantu, samasta loka sukhino bhavantu, samasta loka sukhino bhavantu. Om shanti shanti shanti. Jai Bolo Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba Ji Ki. Thank you.